Hi everyone, I'm sitting with Shabia Ravi Walia, who you must have known her to be an entrepreneur. She's Shabia, why don't you introduce yourself a little bit about, I mean, your product? You are the one who is most passionate about, and I have seen her grow as an entrepreneur. I am one of her those friends who have been there seeing that journey and feeling so proud of her. So why don't you do?
Thanks Koral for this, and so I'm a media girl for 24 years, you know that, and I think 2 years back I just got fed up with the entire deadlines and fragile goals and making other people richer with my intelligence. So I thought, why not put this to good use? And as you know, we started in the kitchen, we started making these products in the kitchen. We started with soaps, and then word of mouth spread, and people started asking for shampoos and body butters, and today we have more than 48 SKUs in our range. All these products are
the brand.
Yeah, the name of the brand is Wild Earth, and it's all natural, handmade, sulfate free, paraben free, absolutely safe for kids, adults, old people, whoever wants to use our products. And yes, I think the intent behind the brand was to provide pure body products at affordable prices, and I think thankfully God has been kind and the brand has worked, and today we export, we sell in retail, we are online. So yeah, Wild Earth is going wild, as I can say.
Of course it will. So my book Rasia is not just about two dancers who are exploring their journey, but it is also about an entrepreneur who is ambitious, who wants to take his brand outside India, and he wants people to know about his art, his skill, and the property that he has created all through. So it just came to our mind that why not talk about entrepreneurship the way we have been. I am a new entrepreneur. Shabia is a seasoned entrepreneur now. And it just came to mind that why not discuss entrepreneurship in context of the book, but not necessarily limited to the structure of the book. So cheers to our ventures.
Cheers. Yeah. In fact, when I was reading the book, so I also can call myself a creative person, and I was talking to someone who said, you know, creative log to business ko duba dete hain, because we only think by our heart. You know, and having said that, I would like to disagree, because I think, yes, we may not be as calculative as the mathematics and, you know, ROI on each product, like, oh, na margin and that. I think what we do is from the heart, what we design is from the heart. So even when we design the marketing, that also is from the heart. And I think when you do the selling too from the heart, I think it passes on to the customer. Like, you know, I never called my brand affordable luxury. Though when we started, the thought was there behind it that yes, it should be luxury which is affordable. Funnily, now people are coming and telling me that your brand is so luxurious, but it's affordable, so it's affordable luxury. And I was like, how did it get translated from my mind to the customer? I've never said it. You know all my posts. You know the marketing we do. It's neither written on any label. And people have started calling it that. So I thought, wow, you know, it's that connection has been made. It's been what I was thinking when I was making the brand that has somehow got translated to my customer. And I think that's a big win for me. The profits and losses keep happening. But I think the biggest value is when what you're trying to say, without being there, your customer has identified it or read it. So when I was reading your book and I was reading the journey of Raj Shekhar, who's a creative person, who's a dancer, who's an artist, but yet he has to look into the business of it, about selling his, you know, dance school abroad. And that's quite an eclectic combination, because we are taught to think from the heart. We are not, you know, the logical and the not using that part of the brain which is very good in maths and calculations.
I think that is one disconnect which I'm very happy that it is bridging with every passing day. Because there was a time when people thought that okay, artists are the jhorawala people who would have frames in on their eyes, and they don't know nothing about money. they are the so-called poor people who struggle in life and work for their art, discounting everything in their life. From there, I think we have come a long way where artists are very, very conscious about what all they can bring to the table and how to use the market in their favor.
Absolutely.
So that is, I don't know whether I should call it, whether I should be happy about it or I should look at it skeptically. But what I understand is if more people are talking about it and more people are getting to know about them, probably a lot of mind blocks are opening out.
Yes.
A lot of things that we held very much against our hearts are now a lot more flexible about it. Shabia, if you are not aware, then Shabia is also the author of a beautiful book called Mama Mania. And her journey has actually started from being a mother. She started writing Mama Mania because she had a lot of things to tell about her pregnancy and she had a lot of things to say to her daughter. And she wrote all of those down and the book was released soon after Sia was born.
Yeah.
And it's that book which brought me and Shabia together, other than being the family.
Her
Shabia
husband reviewed the book.
Yeah, Shabia being my husband's friend. But more importantly, my pregnancy, I know of many others, Shabia has been a very, very strong support. And I knew that whatever I might introduce her as, her biggest introduction is that she's a mother. And whatever she does is actually a reflection of, reflection of the fact that she is a mother. So her motherhood prompts her into things. So Mama Mania happened like that. And it is a beautiful checklist for many of us who have been going through that phase where we are not sure whether we want to take up, where we want to take the plunge, and when we have taken the plunge, what goes ahead. And post that, even Wilder, it started as her realization that a lot of marketing products, a lot of beauty products that are available in the market might not be the right products to be used on a baby. And that's how she started the Wild Earth. And it started as what was the name?
Tattva.
It started as Tattva. And in due course of time, it took a lavish turn and became a big brand called the Wild Earth. And I have used her products on my child when I felt that probably the other products are not that good. And I really, really thank Shabia for for creating this brand. Shabia, this journey I have seen as an outsider, I feel that aap just phat chal, matlab aap just nikle aur matlab main nikla gaddi leke chal gaya. So was it really, really that easy?
Ravni, you know, the funny thing is I've lived my life like that, you know. So so even if you, the way I found my husband, I was a Mumbai girl and I saw Ravi at a shoot. And I told myself, I'm going to marry this guy. Simply because, you know, everyone on the shoot was running around from Winter Skelter. And Ravi was there like a calm force standing like this. And I said, I need this calm in my life. I'm going to marry this guy. And you won't believe what I did after that. I took a ticket to Delhi. I had 600 rupees in my pocket. Went to Delhi, made him fall in love with me. Brought him back as my husband. So he always says, you're the bitch. I did not know that you had planned it all like that. And then of course, when I was planning to get pregnant and it was not happening because we used to travel a lot, and I realized that there were many pregnancy books by doctors, but no Indian woman had written a book on pregnancy, simply because it involved words like sex and words which in the Indian culture are not okay. Now we are at least using them very freely, but 10 years before it was still a taboo subject to talk about sperm count and sex so openly. So in fact, many of my friends called me and said, you're sure your husband won't divorce you after the book? Because I was giving away his sperm count. It was quite hilarious. But yeah, but it essentially started as a diary I was maintaining, and I was wondering, so many emotions go through your mind when you want to become pregnant and you're not conceiving, apart from everyone else asking you what is wrong with you. They never ask the man, they always ask the woman. And even when you pass a toy shop, you're looking at kids' toys. Every other woman looks pregnant except yourself. So I thought these emotions are so beautiful. And I thought, why not write it in a hilarious way? I would put pillows inside my tummy to see how I would look if I was pregnant. And then it became very emotional later when at 5 months the doctor told me that I probably would have a small child and maybe a slow child and maybe I should abort her. And that was a huge turmoil decision. And then I thought, this can become a ready-made guide for other mothers who are struggling with conception and who are struggling to do what to do in the first 3 months after your baby comes. You know, I've been with you when you were pregnant and I think I was one of the first few people who carried me with his arms. So yeah, that was beautiful. And so many mothers have reached out to me after that. Some have even conceived after reading my book. So that's I think one of my achievements.
After Vicky Donner.
Yes, after Vicky Donner, people have really called me and said, we read your book and within 2 months we were pregnant. That I think, and such instances have constantly happened. So when Sia was about 4 or 5 years old and media was getting to me, it was not challenging me in the way I had finished about 24 years in it. But there was nothing more to teach, there was nothing more to learn. Digital, of course, has happened now, but at that time I was like, same stories, the same people, the same fragile egos, the deadline. And I was like, I need to spend more time with my child, and what is it, what legacy am I going to leave her with? And coincidentally, that I realized that there were very few products which were really, really pure as they claimed, for babies. And I said, why not make something which when you say chemical free, is absolutely chemical free, And that's how I started. I ran out of a scrub and I just announced to my husband that I'll make a scrub for myself. I went into the kitchen and I made a scrub. And he said, you know how to make a scrub? And I said, yeah, I'll learn. And I made a scrub, but I ended up making 1 kg. And the next day I went to her school and, the women out there just bought it and I came home with 4,000 bucks. The next day I made another kg, I came back home with 10,000 rupees. And Ravi was like, wow, this is a great business idea, why don't you do this? And then, mothers like you and other mothers kept asking, kya bhi body butter bhi banao, we won't go for a body butter to another brand, make a shampoo. And rato raat, we thought of a name, Tatwa, because that meant essence of nature. My husband, who's a cinematographer, he took some beautiful photographs and we put on Facebook and we got 25 orders the first day. The next day it was 50 orders, and we just kept growing. And now that I look back, I think it was sheer madness. But then that's how I found my husband. And so I think with me, I'm very, very spontaneous. I feel, which is one of the advice I keep giving to a lot of people who come to me for some organizational advice. I always say, don't overthink. Don't think that the day I have 50 lakhs in my account, I have tied up with all the online sites, I have cracked the packaging, and I have all the team and a glass office, is the day I will launch my brand. It never works like that. You evolve as you build your brand. You will learn as you build your brand. The packaging which we had 2 years earlier is not the packaging we have now, because even we have learned what our customers want. So I just feel you have an idea, you have the passion for it, it's giving you a kick, go for it. Don't overthink. The moment you overthink, you kill the idea and it never takes off. I am sure you will agree with me.
Oh yes, actually when I was listening to you, I was thinking that beautiful Parvapanti mein agar competition ho toh humare beech mein tough competition ho sakta hai. I don't know. But I have this really irritating habit. I call it irritating because end of the day, it comes back to me, exhausts me. Or kisi ko kuch fark nahi padta. My habit is that agar mujhe kuch chahiye, or chahiye in the sense in terms of work, agar mujhe kuch chahiye, or immediately agar wo koi khali nahi hai, koi kar nahi raha hai, my habit is to go and learn and do it myself. Ki haan theek hai, tere se paas nahi hai time. तू नहीं करेगा ठीक है मैं कर दूँगी सो माई हैबिट इज मैंने सो आई ट्राई टू लर्न दो सॉफ्टवेयर जिसका मुझे कोई आता पता नहीं है एंड आई एंड बिगड़ोइंग देम अ लिटिल बिट बट आई हैव दिस क्यूरियोसिटी टू लर्न द फ्यू थिंग्स जिसको मुझे लगता है कि हाँ मैं कर लूँगी एंड ये हाँ मैं कर लूँगी बहुत सारी चीज़ों में मुझे लगता है एंड पीपल कीप टेलिंग मी दैट 100% कर लूँगी लेकिन ऑप्टिमाइज योर टाइम इन टू वॉट यू आर बेस्ट एट सो Probably entrepreneurship happens when you get to understand that part of yourself, that what you are best at. Otherwise, karte hum log sab kuch karte hain.
True. And I, you know, you mentioned correctly that entrepreneurship is the only one thing that forces you to accept all the roles possible in that domain. Because when you're an entrepreneur, you try to keep it as lean, you try to keep your team lean, you don't have money.
Yeah.
So I mean, I think for the first two and a half years, I was the CEO of the company, I was the designer of the company, I was the product maker of the company, I was even the delivery boy of the company and the accountant and the chai wala and everything else, right? It's only now that I have the liberty to hire a few people, and even that I say it's only a very few people. It's still a very lean team, though we export to London, Dubai, Canada, Philippines now. But we still are a you know, 5 to 6
Yeah,
member
we
team.
End of the day we our profile, job profile actually range from the chief entertainment officer to the chief creative officer to the head person.
Absolutely.
Yeah,
I mean,
that's
there
how we operate.
When I've told Ravi, take out the car, we have to go and deliver the scrubs. And he's, you know, been the driver of the car, and I sat behind and I'll run up and given deliveries, and then we picked up daughter from school and come back. But you know, there's joy in it, I agree. And as you said, I'm the same type that if I don't have the money to get a person to do it, then I'll crack it myself. And I'll say, fair enough, I'll do it. And but the only drawback of it is exactly that if, when you play so many roles, it's very, very exhausting. And I think somewhere then you're also limiting your creativity, because you get so you get spread out so thinly that you're wasting time on things like now I've started to say no. Like if I have to make 10 bills, I would rather tell my accountant to make it, because in that much time I might do a meeting which will bring me a good deal or a good order. So now, but that comes only I think after 2.5-3 years when you're trying to, you know, at least you've reached break-even point. And, but having said that, I really, really feel that everyone should at least once in a lifetime go through the entrepreneurship experience, because I think it's such a wholesome experience to, which I think a job never gives you. Like if I've been a creative director in a channel or a production house, I've never known what it is to be a CEO of that company and to run the show in that much money. That's not been my concern. You're only focusing on the part which is really easy. But as entrepreneurship, you know, you are from
you
the
actually
captain
get to
the,
see. You actually get side. To see how difficult it is to be the top boss.
It is very difficult, and
yeah.
More than the difficulty part of the operation bit, what is most difficult is to realize that so many people and their families are dependent on you.
To take a decision. मतलब एक yes no, मैंने as an ambitious person कभी कभी बहुत आसान होता है that I want to do it, but then since mine is a completely creative area, it's about stories, it's about a website, it's about a lot of people putting in their efforts, their a piece of their heart, basically. I know what writing is, I know what storytelling is. So probably ambitiously, I would like to touch upon every horizon and bring them back to all my authors and ask them to enjoy that space. But what if while bringing that part of the horizon, I am overlooking certain things that it will bring along with?
True.
That is where the people I am working with, my partners, my well-wishers, they start talking about it. We at times when I am said, I'm told that this is not the right time to do something, go for something, I get very, very annoyed. And I mean, at that moment of time, my aggression is very difficult to handle. But when you sit back and think, you realize that probably what that person was saying is that, do you yet have the bandwidth to go for it? And if something goes wrong, can you salvage a comeback? That decision making is probably the most difficult decision making.
In fact, decision making is the most exhaustive thing. That's why I think from Mark Zuckerberg to Mahesh Bhatt, you know, they've decided that they wear the same color black every day. Because, no, and honestly,
yeah.
You know, I read a lot of biographies nowadays of entrepreneurs who have made it big. And I realize a lot of them, like the other day I was reading that some woman who's really, really very big, I forget her name right now, but she's just stopped deciding what to have for breakfast every day. She's standardizing that I'll have egg one toast and one piece of bacon. Because she does not want to take a decision on what every day I'll have for breakfast. Because through the day, she has to take so many decisions regarding her business. And honestly, I have done that. I did it, I think, very unknowingly. But I think the moment I started getting busy with business, I have completely stopped telling my cook what to cook in the kitchen. In fact, he's been advised that he should not come and ask me. He should ask my husband. Because I do not want to take those decisions. Not because it's not important for me or my family or what they eat is not important to me. But it is something which I can delegate. I cannot delegate my business to someone. But I can definitely delegate this to my husband. Ki, aaj hum sab kya khane wale, wo utna aap decide kar lo. Sabzi wale ke paas kaun jayega, wo aap decide kar lo. Bacche ko kaun lene jayega, wo aap decide kar lo. So that I have my mind space free to take the more important decisions. And you're right, decision making is the most exhausting thing. And even today, the only thing which makes me lose my sleep is that the decision I'm taking, how will I impact, how will it impact my employees' lives? Will I be able to pay them salary for the next month? If I don't get orders in a particular month, it's fine. I mean, I can eat my food and my husband will feed me and But what about my employees? What about their families who are waiting for their salaries?
Correct.
You know, that's the only point till today which makes me lose sleep at times. That what if we don't do well the next month? Thankfully, we've never reached a situation like that. So I think there's a lot of logic and thoughtfulness in the whole thing, that delegate as much as you can and keep the parts at which you excel for yourself.
Absolutely.
But that doesn't come easy. I'm sure it doesn't come easy.
No, yeah, it doesn't, because you're possessive
and somewhere you have this now again, coming from media, you know what happens in media, again you have to be a multitasker. You have to know how to write continuity, at the same time you should know about costumes also, you should also know how to look at the frame and point out what's wrong, you should be the hand holder for the director also. So that also kind of teaches you to be jack of all trades.
Absolutely.
So you get used to that. You feel that you should know everything, and if you delegate it to somebody, and mistakes in media can be very costly, right? You take a wrong decision, a scene is shot wrong, you have to reshoot it. That's like a loss of a lakhs of rupees, right? So even here, so it took me quite some time to learn to delegate, because somewhere in your head, it may be false, but you have this thing that only when I do it, it will be right.
Yeah, exactly. That's the biggest pressure, that at times you feel that, chalo, forgiving myself is easier than forgiving someone else for anything that may have gone wrong. But the truth is, forgiving myself is the most difficult thing to do. You can forgive anybody else. You can forgive anybody else. End of the day, you feel that I couldn't do it. And as much as you love yourself,
you beat yourself very hard.
Yes. It's killing.
Yeah. Especially when you have set very high benchmarks for yourself.
Yes.
But you know, for me, I thought, so I used to tell my office boy to do certain things, and he would always make mistakes. And once I told him, I will put the stickers on the bottles, because you are getting it all wrong. And I realized that when I was putting it, I actually spoiled 4 or 5 of them. And I think that made me realize that the same mistakes, it's possible that I also do it, but there's no one to shout at me for that. And I think it made me forgiving enough to let him get it wrong the first 2-3 times. I think now I lose patience after the 4th or 5th time. Earlier I used to lose patience after the first time and give him hell for it, you know. So I get what you're saying. That's true, that when you make a mistake, you have no one else to shout at you, but you give yourself such a beating that it's...
that kills a part of you.
Yes.
Shabia, in the book, a large part of the book discusses this delegation thing, how important
takes over. Yes.
Yeah, where the wife takes over the husband and the husband doesn't even know that he is being taken over. What was your reaction to the entrepreneurial part of the book?
I think it just reinforced what we are saying, that you know, delegation is necessary. How much ever today I decide that I want to do it all, it's just not possible. Even if my brain is not tired, my body is tired. And when your body and brain is tired, you will not come up with the list of solutions. So it was, I think, very well woven in the book, that without realizing and without telling him that she's going to do it, which she herself also doesn't know, right? She's going through a whole gamut of emotions herself.
It's happening to her.
Yeah, she doesn't even realize that somewhere she's just become a shadow and she's been doing what he's been telling her to do, and then when given the chance, she just shines through. You know, her own self comes out. But she, I think, between Rajshekhar and his wife Mansi, Mansi was the most secure one, right? Obviously, yeah. She was able to delegate it to her team. She had confidence in them. She believed that if they fly, they would still be connected to the roots, which Raj did not have the confidence to accept. Also, when a new person came to threaten her peace, she still had the ability to,
retain as much as required and let go.
And also probably have the confidence that I may allow you in my domain, but it will still remain in my domain, which Raj did not have. So being the man and the considered as the stronger character, it was ultimately Mansi who shone for me and who had great confidence not only in herself but in her team. And I think there's a learning there, right, for even me, that if you've taught your team well, they will deliver. By not delegating to them, you're questioning your own training you've given to them. So that I think helped and reinforced my belief, and I was telling myself I should let my team fly. Enough of hand holding.
So thank you so much. It was a wonderful conversation with Shabia Ravi Walia. You can find her especially on Instagram. I really find her Instagram posts very beautiful and very informative. She is available as The Wild Earth by Shabia Walia. And I am available on Twitter as Koral Dasgupta. If you have anything to ask to either of us, please do reach out. We would love to hear from you.
And do read this wonderful book, Rasia. I have read it over 2 days and I have not kept it down till I finished reading it. So it books you, and it's a great love story, and I'm a sucker for love story, I must tell you. So keep writing more, and please read. It's an excellent book, and I think there is much more than love and romance in the book. So do read.
Thank you so much, and I would not tell you to like, comment, subscribe, but if in any way we have been able to drill something into your brain, or if you feel that there is something good that we have said, do reach out to us and do stay connected. Thank you.